turban does not equal terrorist.
How do you receive food stamps when you live in a rich town?
So you go to a community college, not smart enough for a real college?
Dyslexia does not equal stupid.
No, I don't have court today. I just like to dress like this.
You should go back to where you came from. I'm from here. We're both from here for the same reason, the American dream.
My name is Shea Wadair Fagare. I manage RVCC's partnership on a grant called the Career Equity Resource Center, which is housed at the Center for Women and Work at Rutgers University. During the fall of 2013, a group of faculty members participated in Equity Educator Series around promoting student engagement and equity in the classroom. And the Career Equity Resource Center facilitated those workshops. One of the workshops that we offered was around micromessages with research based on Mary Rowe's work and from the National Alliance for Partnerships in Equity. We essentially talked about how micromessages are those small and subtle ways that we communicate with each other. And micro-inequities, or microaggressions, which is a more common term in academia, are negative messages that we send or receive that are, again, very small, very subtle, pervasive, powerful, usually unintentional, but that doesn't always have to be the case. Micro-inequities tend to be very powerful because they have the ability to make others feel excluded and less than. As you hear students talking about their own micro-inequities, you'll begin to notice that there's a common theme of exclusion and marginalization, irrespective of race, ethnicity, sexual orientation, socioeconomic status, class, and so forth.
My name is Karen Gaffney, and I've been an English professor at RVCC for 11 years. In addition to composition, I teach a course in race and popular culture, which relates to my research on race and class-based stereotypes. In December 2013, I attended a workshop on micromessages, and that was about the time when colleges were first starting to share students' photo projects about various racial micro-inequities. We were really interested in doing a project like that here, but expanding it to include a variety of different ways in which people are oppressed, whether it's related to race, ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation, socioeconomic class, religion, ability, or another area. It's been really rewarding working with these students. They are an inspiration. They've overcome so much, yet their stories show us that there is much work to be done. The micro inequities that we're exploring are damaging. Just because they're called micro doesn't mean they're not significant. In fact, they are ongoing symptoms of larger systems of oppression that are structural and institutional. One way of tackling these larger systems is to explore the stories behind these micro inequities, raise awareness about them, and take action.
My name is Conrad Colon, and my micromessage is dyslexia does not equal stupid. Well, you know, dyslexia is something that I've had to deal with my entire life. From a very young age, you sort of know something's different, but you don't know exactly what is. People have a lot of misconceptions when it comes to dyslexia. Some people think it's a visual thing, that people, you know, you don't see things the same, when in reality you do. It's just a phonological processing error in the brain itself. People don't understand that. They sort of think dyslexia is sort of this bad thing that dyslexics can't read, and that's not true. Dyslexics can read, they just need to change the way they approach reading. As a dyslexic, people sort of label you as sort of the other, or stupid, or not being able to live up to potential, or oh, you're not trying enough, or you're lazy. And I've actually had caseworkers and teachers tell me that, well, let's worry about getting you out of high school. Don't worry so much about college, because you're probably not going to make it to college. Yes, I may have dyslexia, but that doesn't stop me from doing what I want to do. Right now, I'm executive vice president of student government, but as I've sort of grown with my dyslexia, I've sort of learned to cope with it and come up with mechanisms that help me do things that I thought would never be possible. It's all about looking at things differently, and that's what dyslexics do. And if we sort of look at the world differently, not just with learning disabilities, but with any sort of micromessage or stereotype, I think the world would be a better place.
Hi, my name is Nicole, and my micromessage is, You shall go back to where you came from. I'm from here. We're both from here for the same reason, the American dream. The stereotype that my micro message is addressing deals with people asking you, where are you really from? Where are you from? When I state that I was born here, that's usually not good enough. They tend to ask for a different answer, another country. That's what they refer to. But if I were white, they would just be okay and take it in as an American, you know. There is a lot of diversity between the Hispanic countries, and we're not all Mexicans. I think it's important to raise awareness for this because a lot of kids don't have the courage to stand up for themselves. I personally was one of them. Like I mentioned, in high school, I didn't get involved. So when I came to RV, it was very different because there's so much diversity here. It's amazing. And it's great to be able to meet new people from all types of different countries and get involved in clubs and organizations that I thought I could never be a part of. Society would be improved if people were aware of the stereotypes because they would feel more aware of being able to get along with other people from other countries when it comes to the workforce, being able to relate to other people, and learning about different backgrounds. It'll really help them in the future. Unfortunately, this country has not always experienced that. And if you stay within your group, you can experience that.
Hi, my name is Montana, and my message is, no, I don't have court today. I just like to dress like this. When I was in high school, I came into school dressed up one day, and it was actually because I had to go to court later that day for mischief that I caused, outside of school. And one of my friends came up to me and asked, hey, why are you dressed up? Do you have court today? And unfortunately, he was correct, but just by him assuming that really, made me think, why was he assuming that? And, it really helped me to, change my mind frame and, try to understand the stereotype that, young African Americans, or the stereotype is that young African Americans only, dress up when they, A, are going to church, or B, going to court. So I think it's hugely important to raise awareness about this stereotype. One, because of the children, the youth growing up in, troubled communities, for example. If it's all that they see on the media, when they see, young African Americans like themselves that they can relate to, if they see that the only reason that they're dressed up is for, is to go to court, then they won't want to wear, the type of clothing. They won't want to wear professional clothing. And chances are they might not want to go into professional fields just because they feel like they can't relate to it. And I feel like for me, that's one of the biggest reasons why I do it, is to show, the younger kids in the neighborhood that, I don't have a corporate job, for example. I don't have a career or a great paying job or anything. But I dress up to go to school because I like to. Breaking the stereotype is hard because, if it was easy, people would have done it before. But I think people are afraid to step out of their comfort zone.
My name is Donald Treesh, and my micro message is, how do you receive food stamps when you live in a rich town? Well, the stereotype behind this kind of relates just to, obviously, socioeconomic status. But it's kind of a separation of classes.
Back in high school, I used to receive these little lunch tickets. I was like, oh, free lunch. Like, this is great that I get this. And you go in line and you just hand the cashier a ticket and people kind of look at you like sideways, like they really don't know. I did not know, as funny as it sounds, I did not know we were poor until, my early teens, I guess. We grew up, with money. My dad did all kinds of different contracting jobs and whatnot. He moved into my grandmother's house, fixed it up and whatnot. But as you start to put pieces to the puzzle, together, you ask, oh, well, why did we move to this house? What happened to the last house? And, how come mom's truck got repossessed in the middle of the night when everybody's sleeping? And then living in an area that I live in, people are very confused because they don't understand how it's possible to qualify for this type of federal aid when you're living in such a wealthy area where the houses are millions of dollars and everybody's driving nice cars.
they don't see what's underlying with, you know, a lot of these families. I mean, people are really taken back when you're like, oh, how do you receive free food every month? Like, how did you manage that? It's like, how am I managing with that, you know?
Hi, my name is Jennifer Andrini, and my micro message is, you go to a community college, not smart enough for a real college. The stereotype is that if you go to a community college, you're not smart enough to go to a real college, such as a university. It's looked down upon. So when you're in high school, you're brainwashed by your guidance counselors, parents, and peers to think that going to a community college isn't the right choice or the smartest choice, or you're not good enough to go to another college, so that's why you're at a community college, which is totally 110% false. Because, you know, there are really smart students here, there's small classrooms, it's an easy commute, you know, all these different things and factors where that you won't get at a 60,000, you know, student university. And if you have this type of attitude when you start going to school, then that could affect your grades. You won't want to be involved in school. You're not going to join any clubs, and that could just hurt your whole environment and college experience. I want to raise awareness about this negative stereotype so that people aren't brainwashed into thinking that going to a community college is a bad choice. To be honest, having this micro message or stereotype in general makes you feel like very hurtful and, you know, ashamed that you're going to a community college when you shouldn't feel that way. You should be feeling proud that you're going to a community college, you're going to school, it's affordable, and you're getting a great education.
So my name is Kushwant Paul, and my micro message is turban does not equal terrorist. The stereotype behind my micro message is that many people assume that after 9/11, a turban signifies a person part of the Taliban or a terrorist organization. It doesn't equal terrorist, it actually means much more. And for my religion, it signifies a crown of a king, and because my religion is Sikhism. Growing up, I was only Sikh in my high school and middle school, and being different is something I understood, especially after 9/11. So I've been through a lot growing up in terms of being judged every day, being where I see parents bring their children closer when I'm walking because they think I'm a threat. Growing up in high school, a few years after 9/11, I was attacked by a group of men. I had my turban ripped off, and you know, I still remember it like it was yesterday, but the best way to cope with that is not by the same violence that they have given me, but to educate people, understand how to accept people from different backgrounds and the beauty of diversity. I want to raise awareness for this negative stereotype because I am not the only person being affected by this. There's many students from different religions, whether you're Muslim, whether you're Sikh, whether you're a Hindu. You're still judged every day. And I know exactly how that feels like, and I wouldn't want anyone else to feel the same way, no matter what religion they are. One of my goals is to show and educate the students that, you know, if I can do it, you can do it. And it doesn't matter what you look like or what religion you are or where you come from. RVCC embraces all students from all different aspects and all around the world. Some of the things that I believe that we can go against this stereotype is educating students starting in high schools and middle schools, because I think that that's where it kind of starts, because there's a lot of bullying in schools, so that by the time they mature and get into college, they'll be able to embrace diversity.